The Danish writer Hans Christian Andersen is known throughout the world, famed for his fairy tales and his stories. Among them, the wonderfully strange account of his own life is perhaps the most beautiful fairy tale of all. In his own words, "First you go through terrible suffering, and then you become famous." The story of a life that has become a national myth. And what does the myth say? In 1805, in a poor little room in Odense, there lived a newly married couple who were extremely fond of each other. The myth says it was here. From 1807, the family lived here in Munkemüllerstræde. The mother, a washerwoman. The father, a shoemaker, and their son, Hans Christian. One single little room, almost completely taken up by the shoemaker's bench, the bed and the couch where I slept, was my childhood home. The little room seemed big and rich to me. I was an only child and was very much spoiled. "I lived like the son of a count," said my mother. Hans Christian was a quiet child who kept away from the street and the other children. He sewed doll's clothes or sat outside in the yard for hours with his toy theater and the toys his father had made. Or he went with his mother down to the Odense River, where he hid among the dock leaves and gave his imagination free rein. At other times, he stood on a big stone in the river and sang at the top of his voice. "I was a strange dreamer of a child, and I often used to walk with my eyes closed, so that in the end, people thought that I had bad eyesight." In 1987, 100 years or so after his death, a sensational new hypothesis about Hans Christian Andersen went round the world press. Hans Christian Andersen was not born in Odense, and certainly not here. He was an adopted child, born in a manor house on Fyn. And his real parents came from among the highest circles in the country. A Danish historian, Jens Jørgensen, was the man responsible for this discovery. And what did it spark off? If we keep to Hans Christian Andersen's description of his own life, then there are in Danish two main sources. One is the book he wrote in 1855, which has been given the title The Fairy Tale of My Life. That's one thing. The other thing that I think was exciting was that already in 1832, Hans Christian Andersen had written a book that was later given the title The Autobiography. He handed this over to his friends, the Colleen family, with the comment that it was not to be published while he was still alive. If we place the two books side by side, we soon realize that in the autobiography, which was not to be published in his lifetime, there is a wealth of information on names, persons, and experiences that points very much in the direction of an affinity with the royal family. The classic Andersen myth is based on one particular fact, a parish register in which Hans Christian's name appears, stating that he was born on the 2nd of April 1805 at 1 o'clock at night. His parents were married in St. Knud's Church, Odense, and lived in the parish. Yet the parish register containing Hans Christian's name belongs to the church in St. Hans Parish, where they never lived. It's interesting to note, too, that St. Hans Parish is also the parish for Odense Castle, where Prince Christian lived, the prince who later became Christian the Eighth. Hans Christian's mother was in fact none other than the Countess Elisa Ahlefeldt Lauervi. This is Jens Jørgensen's theory. Countess Elisa was only 16 years old in 1805, the year of Hans Christian's birth. She was the daughter of Louise Charlotte and Frederick Ahlefeldt Lauervi from Tranekær on the island of Langeland. She was beautiful and headstrong and had enjoyed a free upbringing. Contemporary rumor spoke of an erotic liaison between Countess Elisa and the 18-year-old Prince Christian, heir to the Danish throne. There was talk of a secret marriage and of a child being placed with strangers. Through his close friendship with Elisa's father, Prince Christian was, as we know, very attached to Tranekær. So the young Hans Christian went to school, where, even though the discipline of the time demanded mechanical swatting and a whipping if you didn't know your lessons, no one laid a hand on him. In The Fairy Tale of My Life, Hans Christian describes his schoolmarm as follows. "The schoolmarm didn't dare to hit me. My mother had made that an express condition when she put me to school. So when I too was one day given a blow with the tawse, I stood up at once, took my book, and without more ado I went home to mother. I demanded to go to another school, and so I did." It comes as a surprise that the boy was sent to school before compulsory education was introduced into Denmark in 1814. Who paid those fees? The poor shoemaker? It's hardly likely. In 1819, Hans Christian was prepared for confirmation into the church. In the autobiography he wrote, "Those who were to be confirmed in St. Knud's Church could go either to the curate, the Reverend Wiberg, or to Archdeacon Tietens. But only the pupils from the grammar school and girls of high birth went to the archdeacon. So his children always stood first in the church. To get above the curate's candidates, I went to the archdeacon, and I was thus the only one who stood together with the grammar school pupils. Tietens had no choice but to take me." I have to admit that for a long time I couldn't understand this, until, that is, I found a poem that had been published in a West Zealand newspaper of the time, entitled "To My Benefactor, Archdeacon Gutfeldt," a man who had died in 1823. I wondered who this Gutfeldt was, and discovered that from 1800 to 1811, he had been rector of Fredensborg Castle Church, north of Copenhagen. A more royal position it's hard to imagine. From 1811 until his death in 1823, he was archdeacon at Holman's Church in Copenhagen. Again, it's hard to imagine a more royal appointment. At one point, Gutfeldt informs Tietens, Archdeacon of Odense at the time, that if a boy should turn up calling himself Hans Christian Andersen and claiming that his mother is a washerwoman, he should do whatever the boy asks. And that's in fact what happened. Only a few days after Hans Christian's confirmation, Archdeacon Tietens was appointed Bishop of Riga. In some mysterious way, Hans Christian gradually found himself mixing with the leading families of Odense. Colonel Hø Gulberg began to take an interest in the strange boy. And one day, he even took him to the castle to be introduced to the prince himself. The prince said that if the boy wanted to take up a trade, he was willing to help him. At this point, it's absolutely crucial we realize that the time we're talking about in Denmark is the period of absolute monarchy. There was a real difference of rank between the king and the barons and the counts and the nobles and right down through the system. And yet, from 1816 to 1819, we note that Odense Castle becomes the young Hans Christian's playground, and that he gives his playmate the nickname Prince Fritz. Now, Fritz is in fact Prince Frederick, later King Frederick VII, again an absolute monarch. How can we explain this if we stick to the classic myth of the poor Odense boy? Anyway, Hans Christian didn't want to learn a trade. He wanted to be famous. And one day, he told his mother he wished to go to Copenhagen to seek his fortune. His mother broke into tears, but in the end, she agreed to call a wise woman. Her son will be a great man, the woman predicted. One day, the city of Odense will be illuminated in his honor. And in 1867, he was celebrated as an honorary citizen in the city of his birth, Odense. And so the prediction was fulfilled. But back on that sunny afternoon in 1819, he kissed his mother goodbye and set out from Odense for the king's city, Copenhagen. With a little bundle and 10 Rhys dollars in his pocket. As it turned out, in the capital, all the doors of the finest people miraculously opened to him. But first, he had to go through terrible suffering. He was, in fact, welcomed into the homes of a number of distinguished people who did give him money. And soon he was taken on as a student at the Royal Theatre. But he was a failure. He was simply no good. He lacked culture, they said. And they sent him off to Dr. Meisling at the grammar school in Slagelse. Andersen spent a miserable time there, suffering endless humiliations. But when deliverance came, he returned to Copenhagen and was received into the highest circles again. In Brockdorff's palace at Amalienborg, Henrietta Wolff became his best friend and confidant. The city palaces had opened up for him. Now it was the turn of the country manors. Everywhere among the landed gentry, the doors were open and a room made ready for him. And it was not until now that he began to write his fairy tales. He became famous abroad. He was praised by princes. And in his native land, Hans Christian Andersen became a welcome guest at the king's palace. The swamp plant from the deep, he had called himself. Now he was on top. Now he could begin to write the myth about himself, the fairy tale of his life. The story of my life will tell the world what it tells me. There is a loving God who guides everything for the best. But was it God alone? Shortly after his confirmation, Hans Christian had set off on his travels, in his own words, as a stowaway from Odense. Stowaway needs to be taken with a pinch of salt. For he carried with him the travel pass issued by the chief constable, as well as letters of recommendation from the colonel and an editor called Mr. Everson. Both these gentlemen belong to the social circle at Odense Castle, while at Mr. Everson's country residence, Mariashøj, the city's leading families congregated. On Monday morning, the 5th of September, 1819, I saw Copenhagen for the first time. At Frederiksberg, when I first saw the towers that I so longed for, I broke into tears and felt that I had no one left except God in heaven. My first trip in the city was to the theater. I walked around it several times and regarded the whole building as a home that had not yet opened up to me. Hans Christian wanted to be a ballet dancer, and already the following day, he visited the dancer, Miss Schall, presented his letter of recommendation, and began to dance. She thought he was mad and had him shown out. Giuseppe Siboni, leader of the Royal Theatre's singing school, told him that he'd never make a singer either, because his voice had broken. Without hope, and soon without money or a roof over his head, he found himself standing out in the street. He was no good. And yet, later, he did manage to get into the Royal Theatre, where he remained for 3 years, though without getting any parts worth mentioning, without a contract, without pay. And yet he still maintained a perfectly normal way of life for a young man in Copenhagen. How could this happen? In the fairy tale of my life, Andersen wrote, "A Copenhagen lady, who, like me, had traveled as a stowaway on the coach to Copenhagen, gave me shelter and food." Who was this lady? Let's return to that afternoon in Odense when Hans Christian boarded the postcoach as a stowaway. The lady in question was a Mrs. Hermansen. She was carrying letters of introduction, so her presence was not a coincidence. We also know for certain that she was employed at Odense Castle as a nurse for Prince Ferdinand. She remained in Copenhagen for 6 months and ensured that Hans Christian received private tutors in a number of subjects. One of his teachers was the professor appointed by the royal family to educate the royal children. But while he was paid for teaching the others, he received nothing for teaching Hans Christian. Mrs. Hermansen also intervened in a number of other areas, so she can hardly be called a stowaway. That's more or less the background until he makes his real breakthrough. And that's where I believe Hans Christian Andersen's biological father is the later Christian the Eighth. Assuming that is the case, he was probably born at a manor house on Funen. I believe it to be Broholm Manor, a house where there are myths, where there are stories, and have been for the last 150 years, about the baby boy that was born and placed in the hands of good people. And an addition to the myth is that the boy's father later became Christian VIII. We also know that Elisa Arlefelt Lauervie gave birth to a child. She gave birth later to another daughter whose father was also Christian VIII. We know one thing that I think's intriguing. That is that already in an epilogue to his doctoral thesis in 1907, Professor Brix writes that in 1812, Hans Christian's mother, the washerwoman Anna Maria Andersen, revisited Broholm Manor and probably stayed there 9 months or a year, according to Professor Brix. The lady of this manor was called Ethel Maria Kjær. She was the daughter of the parish clerk in Marslev. And since this same clerk had a housekeeper in her service from 1802 until around February 1805, we can perhaps say that in one sense, the wheel has come full circle. For many will naturally ask, how is it that such a boy, born at Broholm Manor could possibly end up with Anna Maria Andersen. In spite of his failures, the circle of benefactors grew. Several of them, such as the composer C.F. Weiser, collected money for him. The still very young Hans Christian was a regular visitor at Bakkehuset, the home of Professor Rabeck and his wife Kammer. Here the great minds of the time met in a sort of literary salon. From Bakkehuset, the path led to Frederiksberg Castle, and thus to the Crown Princess, who for the rest of her life remained Andersen's patron. In 1822, Hans Christian was sent to the grammar school in Slagelse. His board and residence, as well as his pocket money, were paid for out of the royal purse. And one of Denmark's most influential men now stepped forward as his guardian and benefactor, Jonas Collin. For the 17-year-old boy, the school's headmaster, Dr. Meisling, became quite simply an evil spirit. "Shakespeare with the vampire eyes," he called him, while Dr. Meisling said of his pupil, "You are lazy and intolerable, a mad creature and a stupid fool. I'm heartily sick of you." Finally, the unhappy boy sent a cry of distress to the all-powerful Jonas Collin. "Do not abandon me. I have only you. You it is who must grant me life or death." In the Collin's family, Andersen had found a fixed point for the rest of his life. The home of homes, he called it. He shared in the entertaining parties as well as the distressing sorrows of the home. And with Edward, the son of the family, here seen together with his wife Henrietta, he maintained a lasting friendship through thick and thin. In 1827, Andersen was brought back to Copenhagen, where he took up residence in a tiny attic. "I still had a little sum left over from the king, but I had to save in every possible way." He now began to make the rounds of the city's finest houses as a dinner guest. "At Commander Wolf's at Amalienborg on Monday, at Privy Councillor Collin's on Tuesday, Councillor Olsen's on Wednesday, Councillor Ørsted's on Thursday, Mrs. Muffelman's on Friday, and Steward Balling's on Saturday. Sunday I kept free, as I'm always being invited out." Again we see the same pattern. Without more ado, the young man is welcomed into the leading families of Copenhagen. The 1830s saw him beginning to do the rounds of the Danish manor houses, a progress which lasted right up until his death. "I met up with what are regarded as the first families in the land, kind and cordial people, who took me into their circle and allowed me in their rich summer life to share in their happiness. There I could freely give myself over to nature, to woodland solitude, and the life of the manor. Here I wrote most of my fairy tales." The first circle opened up to him on Funen. "In the summer life of the Funen manors, I found the friendliest of welcomes, the coziest of homes, and on my quiet wanderings here, I probably learned more reflective wisdom than the school could ever give me." In 1836, he was at Lukasholm on Funen. "Here I stayed a whole 3 weeks," he writes to Henrietta Wolf. "But you must also remember that life is very pleasant here, that there are big rooms to walk around in, and I do not feel happy until I am in big rooms." During his stay, he did this drawing of Lukasholm. And from Lukasholm, he was invited by the Count to nearby Glorup. "It is a stay very much to my taste," he wrote, again to Henrietta Wolf. "The Count is extremely charming. Never in any place have I had such a princely time and been so free and easy as here." But he was not completely free and at ease. One day a man turned up at Glorup asking for money. When he saw Andersen, he said, "Weren't you born somewhere around Odense?" Andersen quickly gave him a sum of money and sent him packing. Did the man know something? Another day, the company from Glorup drove out to a holy well in the woods. There at the well stood a nasty vagabond. I had a feeling that perhaps he knew who I was and could say something unpleasant, as though I were a pariah come from a higher caste. In 1842, Andersen was invited to spend a holiday at Gisselfeld on South Zealand, the home of Count and Countess Danneskjold Samsø. Here I was no poor child of the common folk, but a warmly received guest, he wrote in the fairy tale of my life. And in his journal we find, "I have the room on the right as you drive out of the gate, light and comfortable. I'm happy with this cozy home." At Gisselfeld, the room has stood more or less untouched since Andersen left it for the last time. It was probably here that a few days after Andersen's arrival, the Count informed him that the Copenhagen audience had booed the previous night's premiere of Andersen's The Bird in the Pear Tree. In his journal for the same day, Andersen wrote, "Against my will, I became disheartened and wandered around in the woods and the fields, feeling ill at ease. I got the idea for The Story of a Duck. That helped my spirits a little." That was on the 5th of July. 3 weeks later, we find the laconic words, "Started on The Signet." Perhaps it helped the writer that in the middle of it all, on the 15th of July, he received in the post a brilliant ring from the king. A year or so later, the signet was finished. At the last moment, the story was given another title, The Ugly Duckling. And what is it all about? Hans Christian Andersen knew who he was, or at any rate who his father was. At what point he found out, we don't know for sure. But I would say, even though I'm a historian encroaching on the literary domain, that by the time he wrote The Ugly Duckling in 1843, he certainly knew who his biological father was. Andersen himself said later of The Ugly Duckling that it was a reflection of my own life. And it seems as if writing down the fairy tale had a liberating effect on him. After publication of the book, Andersen wrote to a poet and friend, "I believe that I have now found out how to write fairy tales. Now I tell stories out of my own breast. I have plenty of material. It often seems to me as if every hoarding, every little flower says, 'Look at me, then my story will be part of you.' And if I do, I have the story." And straight ahead, out of the thicket, came three beautiful white swans, ruffling their feathers and floating so lightly on the water. The duckling recognized the splendid creatures and was overcome with a strange feeling of melancholy. "I will fly across to them, those royal birds. They will peck me to death for daring, ugly as I am, to go near them. Never mind." "Yes, kill me, kill me," cried the poor creature, and bowed his head to the water, awaiting death. But what did he see there in the clear stream? It was a reflection of himself that he saw in front of him, but no longer a clumsy, greyish bird, ugly and unattractive. No, he was himself, a swan. It doesn't matter about being born in a duckyard, as long as you are hatched from a swan's egg. In 1844, Andersen travelled to the North Sea island of Fur. It was now 25 years since he had left Odense, and that 25th anniversary was to be celebrated, he wrote. I was to be together with my king and queen, whom I am faithfully attached to, whom I have had the opportunity to get to know so well, and for that very reason to love with all my soul. I felt as if I was being led to a summit from which I could see even more clearly behind me how everything had happened and proceeded for the best. Reality often exceeds the most beautiful dreams. To Edward Colleen he wrote, 25 years ago I came to Copenhagen with a little bundle, a poor strange boy, and today I have drunk cocoa with the Queen. At the royal table, I sat opposite her and the king. Everything over here is really like a dream to me. His journal describes walks by the sea and in the sand dunes. According to a particularly tenacious rumor, there was yet another private guest at the court on Fur, Miss Fanny. Miss Fanny was reputedly born in 1805 at Plön Manor in Holstein, and immediately after her birth, placed in the care of a foster mother. Her real mother was Princess Charlotte of Mecklenburg-Schwerin, and Miss Fanny's father was no less than Prince Christian himself, later Christian VIII. King Christian VIII died in January 1848. Andersen wrote, "On the 20th of January, I went out to Amalienborg Palace several times. In the evening, I stood in the courtyard in the snow, looking up at the windows behind which my king lay dying. At a quarter past 10, he passed away. I went home and cried deeply and intensely for him whom I loved so ineffably and whom I now had lost." A few pages further on in the fairy tale of my life, we find this interesting addition. On the very day that King Christian VIII died, we know that a wild swan flew into the spire of Roskilde Cathedral and broke its breast. It is astonishing how doors opened for Hans Christian Andersen, especially during his youth. Because the fact is, he was welcomed before he became famous. When, in his later years, he began to visit Friesenborg Manor, it is much less remarkable. Now he is a European celebrity. And now it is just as much the leading families who bask in the reflected glory. Thank you. At Friesenborg in the East Jutland woods lived Count Krag Ulvin Fries, the premier manor owner and the richest man in Denmark. Like another Sun King, he had had Friesenborg rebuilt as a veritable castle. Here life was lived in great style, with a household that surpassed the king's. Andersen wrote, "Came to Friesenborg Monday evening. It is a magnificent building, with rooms that were resplendent in gold and colors, a Moorish splendor. Everything is royal. I was given a big, beautiful room on the same side as 2 years ago. I lack nothing. I only have to ask. Sunshine, I am very well indeed. We live like princes. Every evening, red wine, sherry, white wine, some rare vintage, or another expensive red wine, and champagne." Otherwise, the days passed with the routine that Andersen learned through a lifetime's tramping around the world of fine folk. "I am living like the son of a count," he often said, but he worked for his bread. He was taken round on visits and shown off to friends. He went for walks, made poses, and read aloud for the ladies until he felt ill. "Read as usual from 1 until 2:30. Today I read The Marsh King's Daughter and The Snail and the Rose Tree, and got a pain in the chest when it became too much. After I had already become tired, the Count asked me to read The Will-o'-the-Wisps. Made poses for the ladies. Thursday. Today I have made 11 poses. Left the company and walked round the garden. By the pond, another fairy tale burst into life." Walked alone in the avenues outside the garden. Monday. Read aloud far too long. Walked deep into the woods. And he had himself photographed. Wednesday. In spite of a chest cold, sat on the staircase to be photographed. Got some 30 photographs of myself. Since the 1830s, Andersen had been almost constantly on the move. Now he was tired. In 1874, he was at Bregentved on South Zealand. Here he wrote, "No fairy tales come to me anymore. In the wood under the old oak trees, I am reminded that the old oak tree has told me its last dream a long time ago. I get no new fresh impulses, and that is sad." In the last years of his life, Hans Christian Andersen lived here at number 18 Nyhavn in Copenhagen. He died in 1875. He lies buried here in Assistens Churchyard in Copenhagen. One of his last great joys was when he was told on his 70th birthday that his statue in the King's Gardens was assured. That was how he wished to be remembered. Another statue stands in Odense. Andersen on his travels. Andersen as an observer. "To travel is to live," he once said. No other European writer of his time travelled more than he did, and his travel journals are still read to this day. But it is as the writer of fairy tales that Hans Christian Andersen is remembered throughout the world. He wrote about what he had seen and experienced. His material was his own life. One of his young admirers recalls, "To hear him read The Ugly Duckling gave a glimpse of an understanding of what feelings and sufferings this rare and abused human soul had gone through in order to create this little undying work of art. He was a man who had done battle to the last, and he was for us an eminent and a distinctive spirit as he sat there in his chair, his wonderful head bowed over the book, the words of which he knew by heart." A king's son or not, among writers, Hans Christian Andersen ranks with the greatest.